Hi again, everyone. Chris Tisdell here again. In this presentation, I'm going to continue my series of videos on complex numbers. Now, in the previous presentation, I showed you a way to write complex numbers in a new way that relied on a length and an angle. And I referred to that as the polar trig form. In this presentation, I'm going to show you another way to write complex numbers. Call again using a length and an angle, but this time we're going to use an exponential and we're going to call it the polar exponential form. So I'll show you where it comes from, I'll motivate it, and let me get started and I'll share my screen with you. All right, so in previous presentations we've talked about the Cartesian form, so this x plus yi form, and the polar trig form, which it relies on, say, polar coordinates, where you've got a length r to the origin, and theta is the angle to the positive real axis. So you sort of plot your, geometrically speaking, you plot your point in the complex plane, and you draw a little line segment to the origin, you call that your r, and the theta is measured to the positive real axis. And as we rotate, say, anti-clockwise, theta increases, and if you rotate clockwise, theta decreases. Okay, now, sometimes it is convenient, for example, multiplication, and when we're solving polynomial-type equations, it's convenient to express complex numbers in yet another equivalent form, which I'm going to call the polar exponential form. Now, it still relies on a length and an angle, but you see I've got an exponential here with an I and a theta in the exponent, okay? And E is just the famous magic number E, which is about 2.7183 as the base, okay? And essentially, we can get this from the polar trig form through a fantastic identity, very famous, called Euler's formula, or Euler's identity, if you like. So just to spell it out for you, if I have, say, a complex number, then a polar exponential form is this form here, still using a length and an angle, but we have this r e to the I theta form. And say if we're given a number in Cartesian form, in the x plus yi form, you know, to compute r, we just apply this formula, which is nothing more than Pythagoras. You've got a right angle triangle here. And using trig, you can come up with tan theta equals y over x. Okay? All right. So how do we get from here to here? Well, we use an idea called Euler's formula. Now, Euler's formula is the following. E to the I theta is cos theta plus I sine theta. These two things are equal. Okay, now I've proved this in another video. Okay, so I'm not going to prove that now, but it's a very, very famous formula named after the Swiss mathematician Leonard Euler. Okay, now if you put in, say, for example, theta equals pi, here you'll get e to the pi or e to the I pi. Cosine of pi is negative 1, and sine of pi is 0, so that'll disappear. So you get this very famous formula, okay, e to the pi I equals negative 1, or the same as e to the pi I plus 1 equals 0. Okay, so this is one of the famous identities, I guess, in mathematics that link five of the most famous constants in mathematics, e, pi, I, 1, and 0. Okay? Okay, so anyway, back to the polar exponential form. R to the I theta, where R is the distance to the origin, and theta is an angle to the positive real axis. Okay, now, because I discussed this in the previous video as well, but because Oh, hang on, did I talk about the proof? Oh, hang on. Let me just show you where this comes from a bit more. Okay, all you do is you basically go up there and replace this with this, okay? So cosine theta plus I sine theta gets replaced with e to the I theta. So that just becomes, the thing in brackets just becomes e to the I theta. We're getting carried away with Euler's formula. I forgot to actually show you where this came from. Okay, all right, now a slightly disturbing thing is that the angles are not unique associated with these sort of representations. So for each complex number, there are an infinite number of ways of expressing it in these polar exponential forms. Okay? And why? Because cosine and sine are periodic with period 2, they 2 pi. They repeat themselves. Okay? So let me give you an example here, and I talked about this in a previous video as well. Suppose I have 1 plus I theta. Okay, this is a polar trig form of Z, and of course this will be a polar exponential form. But because cosine and sine are periodic, I can say add 2 pi to this angle and add 2 pi to this angle, and these two things are equal. Okay, so instead of having the pi on 4 here, I can put 9 pi on 4 and 9 pi on 4 there, and this would be my corresponding polar exponential form. This is a little bit worrying because you go, okay, well, shouldn't we have some sort of definiteness? Shouldn't there only be one value? Well, to put some definiteness in here, we introduce what's known as a principal argument. So the angles associated with these forms are called an argument of Z. An argument. Now, okay, so pi on 4 is an argument of this, 9 pi on 4 is an argument of this, okay? And they're not unique. Okay, so to provide some definiteness, we introduce what's known as the principal argument of Z. And basically, the take-home message is that the principal argument of a complex number is always between negative pi and pi. That is the important message here. Okay, now notice up here we've got a lowercase a, and for the principal argument we've got an uppercase a. So when you see uppercase a for arg, we're talking about a definite value that's unique, okay, that always lies between negative pi and pi. Okay, so suppose I was given this form here, and I wanted to say simplify it so that the angles were actually the principal argument. You could look at this and go, okay, well, I can split that up and I can take away 2 pi from these values, and I'll end up with a value that is between negative pi and pi. So pi on 4 is an argument of 1 plus I, 9 pi on 4 is an argument of 1 plus I, but the principal argument of 1 plus I is pi on 4, because pi on 4 is between negative pi and pi, and 9 pi on 4 is not between negative pi and pi. Okay, so that, in a nutshell, that's how we get some definiteness into the way of writing complex numbers in this polar exponential form, and you would use a principal argument. Okay, now this polar exponential form is going to be great for solving polynomial equations and also fantastic for simplifying multiplication, because you can just use the exponentiation laws, and I'll do some examples in some forthcoming videos about that. Okay, all right. So that's a little basic introduction to polar exponential forms. In other videos, I'll do some examples and some detailed examples, which pretty much need their own video to really explain them. So I'm going somewhere with this, and I hope you can join me for the forthcoming presentations where I'll talk about some more examples. If you have any comments, any questions, any feedback at all, any suggestions, please feel to put them in the comment section below. And hope you can join me for the next presentation where I'll continue my series of videos on complex numbers. Bye.